back from Vegas and back from the half dead.
Yeah, for real.
You got your yearly cold out of the way. Well, hopefully you won't have another one.
Man, this is the worst one yet, man.
Oh, really?
Yeah, Monday night, man. Which I ain't gonna say Monday night. I was running a fever about 102, man.
And you didn't go to the doctor?
Nah.
Okay, so this is how we determine exactly how bad it was. In the span of time that you were sick, how many push-ups did you do?
I ain't do any push-ups, though.
It was bad.
No, I was literally, like, under the sheets doing this.
Okay.
Because I was shivering. I was shivering. I was like, man, I might need to go to the doctor.
Yeah, 102-degree fever. I'm shivering under covers.
Did we do an episode about men's health?
We did. It didn't rub off?
Well, I got my checkup in May, so I'm good money.
It's March, and you're sick right now, though.
Time will come, man. Yeah, I get there. I feel better now.
Okay.
I feel better now.
Typical dude.
I know.
Absolutely. I can't really knock you. I mean, I'm making jokes because it ain't me.
I know. Because you wouldn't win either.
No, I probably wouldn't.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah,
I know. Yeah. People kept telling me, "Hey, man, use some antibiotics. You'll feel better." I'm like, "Hey, man,
you need a prescription for antibiotics, don't you?"
Yeah, I gotta go to the doctor for that.
They act like they don't know.
I'm like, "Yo, dog, vitamin C, dog. I'm good money.
Give me some orange juice.
I'm good money.
I'm straight.
It's just a virus. Nobody gonna fight it off anyway.
Yeah,
it gonna take time. It's got to process."
Crazy.
Yeah, for sure, man.
Yeah.
Well,
go ahead, man.
Go ahead. I'll say because apparently we only introduced three of us, and there's four of us sitting at the table.
Oh, no doubt.
So it looked kind of weird us talking to each other, and Rob and I jumping in, man. So,
without further ado,
we got to introduce our illustrious guest today.
Illustrious. Illustrious starts with an I, not an E. Illustrious.
Hey, dog.
That's that Kershaw County education right there, bro.
Hey, dog. Can you please let a player be a player?
Go ahead. Break it down. Go ahead and enunciate that word.
I'm saying.
Illustrious.
With
a bell ass, I ain't going to.
You know what I'm saying? Dog, let my persona be my persona.
Go ahead, man. Go ahead. I'm going to back up off you.
He won't correct everybody's grammar.
That's what
pops.
I do.
It's pops, man.
Yeah.
Basically, that's what I do, man. But Robert, man.
Yeah.
Welcome to the show.
Oh, man. I appreciate y'all having me, man. Glad to be here.
Absolutely, glad you're here, man. Before we get any further, man, just whatever you want to tell the people, man, introduce yourself, man. Tell them who you are.
All right. How should I come at this, man? Because I like the show, man. Y'all straight up. Not too serious. So I ain't going to get too serious.
And obviously, Mike did not be like, you know what I'm saying? Here's your full name. Here's what you do. He was like, hey, this is Robert. Robert, tell him about yourself.
We're going to get into that, though, during the conversation. That's what we're going to do.
That's cool. Oh, well.
We just told him in the beginning we're not going to do an interview.
But anyway, like you say, I'm Robert Wylie. I'm the founder of Good Kids. Good Kids stand for Growth Over Odds and Doubt Kids. It's a nonprofit organization that started here in Columbia.
Okay.
Over the past 3 years, mm-hmm. we actually went international. So
that's dope.
We got a chapter here, St. Lucia, Trinidad, and Haiti.
Okay.
Wow, so okay. Yeah, so we trying to get it around.
So when we getting that invite though?
Yeah. So I said like we mentor youth through sports and creative arts.
Okay.
And with that direction, mm-hmm. you know, we dealing with us because we feel that when I started it, I feel that catches the fullness of us. Mm-hmm. You know, from the sports side, creative arts side, you know, mm-hmm. you could get who we really are.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, that cover a lot of ground. So
okay.
That's how we started, man. It's how we're coming over our 11th year.
Okay.
That's dope, man.
You're doing it for a minute.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Long time.
Yeah. Been out here. Been out here, man.
Okay. So you only been in Columbia with the chapter for 3 years?
No.
It started here. Okay. Okay.
Yeah, we've been here since the beginning. We just been out internationally.
Internationally. Okay. I got you. Okay. That's dope, man. So how you got involved with that, man? Why sports?
I mean, why sports?
Yeah.
That's what I know. That got me out of my situation.
Okay.
You know, took me farther than I could ever think until I went there. Changed my mentality. You know, got me who I am today mm-hmm. by doing that. That's how, I would say that's what I knew.
Okay.
Like, but as far as with the organization and how that got started.
Yeah.
It's a long story. I'm trying to cut it down.
Hey, man, we got time, though.
Yeah.
We got time, though. It's a conversation, man. We'll have to speak in tidbits.
Yeah. Well, I played college. I'm from here.
Okay.
Played at Keenan High School.
Okay.
went to college up in Illinois, man. And when I was up there, let me rewind. I'm just like probably y'all, anybody else, sports fan and a big sneakerhead.
Yeah.
Shoes.
Yeah.
Got up there, man, and got deeper into the shoe situation while I was playing basketball.
Mm-hmm.
Met some guys that was in the shoe game. They got me in the shoe game.
You know? Okay.
It's 2002. Mm-hmm. And that probably started the entrepreneurship within mm-hmm. me, you know.
Okay.
Started selling shoes, not just buying them, selling them. You know how it is in college. You know, them pockets get kind of tough.
Yeah.
So I had to figure out how to make money to get them and how to support myself.
Yeah.
So I started doing that, man. And that fight, the entrepreneurship, the sports side, started fighting with each other, man.
Yeah.
And I got real deep into the business. Made a lot of good money early and young and didn't really realize it until I started, you know, to sit down and looked at it.
Mm-hmm.
So played ball, man. Came back home. Actually, my junior year, I came back. I just like money. You know what I'm saying? Basketball was faded.
Yeah.
So I came back. Went to Greenview Park. That's where I grew up playing, man. That's my neighborhood.
Another shout out.
I went in there, and it was a kid in there. You know, I'm not going to say the name of the kid because of the, you know, parent.
Yeah.
I don't know. So, but anyway, somebody asked me to train the kid. I told him, hey, I don't do basketball. I'm in the business.
Yeah.
You know, that's so, what I did. I like money.
Yeah.
So, I turned down an opportunity, man, and then that's where the story kind of changed, because that particular kid actually got killed 2 weeks later. So I had a little guilt trip with that personally, man. But they say everything happened for a reason.
Yeah.
You know, and it's a lot of great things could come out of tragic situations. Felt a little guilty, man, and got with an old coach of mine, started coaching with him. This probably was around 2006. Got with him, and what I've been going through. I played basketball at the highest level, as far as you're talking about travel ball, summer ball. I did all that.
Yeah.
And I kind of didn't see the same. I know what messed a lot of people up when I was coming up in that era. So I kind of felt like he wasn't doing it the right way. So I started my own thing. And in the midst of starting it, I didn't think that we needed the mentoring part into it for our young men. And it was kind of crazy. I got into it. I didn't start mentoring right away on the basketball side. I kept them separate.
Yeah.
But I volunteered down at Olympia with a guy named Jimmy Wright. He had Concerned Black Men.
We know Jimmy.
Yeah, we know Jimmy.
Absolutely.
And that was a crazy year, because that was the same year the Katrina.
Okay.
Oh, wow.
So those kids was there. Mm-hmm. So I started seeing
all kind of dynamics
of it, man. And kind of took hold of the mentoring part. Started getting creative with that, man. And it grew from there, man. And that's how Good Kids was started. I went to the community. I didn't do it the traditional way. Never did the one-on-one type thing, because I was bad growing up.
It didn't mean you got experience. That's
I had experience. Exactly. Yeah. So, it didn't work. You know, I appreciate everybody that tried it, but you know, after we out their presence, they give us the free food, take us to the games, we back to the old self.
Yeah,
so
you right back where you was at.
Yeah, man. Mm-hmm. So I always try to be creative with what we did. So we went to the communities, man. I know what worked for me was getting me out my environment.
Yeah.
So we took kids different places. I didn't just do sports, like I said, creative arts. That's how that came in. We took the kids like to the radio stations, production studios.
Yeah.
Just showing them different, man. And I was kind of surprised where some kids never been out of their community. I pile them in the car, we go from North Main to the Big DM on Goddard's Ferry. They act like they went out of town.
Like that. He went cross town.
So I took that and, you know, seeing what little things, you know, really matter to a lot of those kids, man. And got into it, man. Got heavy, got deep into it, and it just keep growing year after year. So that's how we started. I'm going to get to where we at right now. I'm going to try to break it down.
Hey, man, take your time, brother.
Yeah. Okay, yeah.
I'm enjoying it, man.
Yeah, grew heavy on the basketball side, man, real heavy. And I'm just that person that if I'm going to do something, I need to do it right.
Mm-hmm.
And if I'm tell you I could do something for you, I need to be able to do it. If I can't do it, I'm going to go find it.
Yeah.
So keep your word. Yeah.
Yeah. Got heavy on the basketball side and the mentoring side. Didn't focus too heavy. I got away from the mentoring side because I wasn't the best, but I knew the basketball side.
Yeah.
So built our teams up. We had a team called Team Good.
Mm-hmm.
We went did pretty good. Had a lot of great players.
Was this a AAU squad?
Yeah.
Okay.
Travel basketball. Yeah. We actually I got a deal after doing that for 3 years. We got an Under Armour deal.
Okay.
That was pretty good.
That was my next question.
Yeah. We got an Under Armour deal, but that wasn't good enough. That's what I'm getting into. Got that deal. Did everything he needed to do, but we still ain't get over that hump from a financial standpoint.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So. Met some people, went to a tournament, and I love telling this story, though. Went to a tournament in Richmond, and met some people up there. I thought we was doing it. We had 16s, you know, got nice vans. We staying in the Marriott, you know, looking good. And yeah. I see another team there. They might have had 8. And they driving Mercedes Sprinters. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, wow.
We in the Marriott, they in the Embassy Suites. So I'm like, yo, how you here? You know, I'm trying to figure this out.
Yeah,
and just from the knowledge of it, I learned a different aspect, the political part of basketball.
Mm-hmm.
So I talked to the brother, and the brother say, well, one of our parents' players' dad is an agent. So I'm like, an agent? Mm-hmm. I thought you couldn't. Bitch match, you know, I thought you couldn't do that.
Yeah.
But in reality, the rules, you really can. Yeah. So, so what I did, I felt like now, okay, I'm lying to my kids because I might got them right in the gym, but as far as I wasn't up on the political side of this game, you know, the business side.
Mm-hmm.
So I ended up, you know, split with the guys I was with, sent my better kids to other teams where they still get looks. You know, they ended up going to college. And restarted things. I got out of the basketball side as far as being a coach, and I started working for the past about four years now, working with an agent, NBA agent. So I do that on the side, and that's pretty cool. It's just a business relationship to help the kids farther down the road.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And that's the business side, so I'm learning a lot from that. This year, actually, I partnered with some other organizations around here, and we brought a team back here, and we got a Nike. As I was telling earlier, we got a Nike team here.
That's dope.
I'm jumping back into it.
Yeah.
But I'm staying back and doing the business side.
Okay.
From the mentoring part, we do, I think it's our fifth year. That was our eighth, like coming up on ninth year, but fifth year is we restructured it. We do a big summer camp called SLAM Summer Camp, stand for Sports, Literacy, Arts, and Media. So we put all that together, got the mentoring part. I mean, it's well ran. I would say I put my camp against anybody camp, you know. And that been going well from us. That's kind of our flagship, as far as our organization. We do a lot of other little things. I guess that may come up later on in what we do. But that's kind of it. That's where we at right now. I skipped something that was very important, but that'll probably come back.
Yeah,
get to it.
So how y'all like that for the intro?
You know what I'm saying? No, that's thorough. You talking about you laid it
short version.
You laid it all the way down.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
That's dope. Yeah, I see why you didn't say anything, Mike.
I'm saying you gotta let the people breathe though.
Yeah, let that man speak for himself.
I'm saying sometimes we don't have to talk.
Rarely, you know, you really take advantage of that.
I do. I really do, man. I really do. So, you had mentioned earlier, man, that you can relate to some of the kids, some of the situation they came from, man. How was your upbringing? What kind of like male influence you had in your life coming along?
That's good. Man, that's a great question. I thought I had the best upbringing in the world. Just be honest.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
If we struggled, I ain't know. Either my mom camouflaged it real good, or I didn't mind. You know, the little stuff.
Yeah.
Didn't really realize it wasn't that great until, like I say, I got out of my environment.
Yeah.
You know, all the stuff that's out in the world started looking a little different and a little better.
Yeah. Started to tell you something was right.
Yeah. As far as male influence, man. Positive male influence, I say that.
I mean, any male influence.
Man, you can start there, but
yeah.
Okay. Make sure you get to all of it.
Yeah.
Man, I mean, all my influences coming up, man. It, if I look back now, I'm gonna say 99% of it probably was negative. Yeah. Oh no, I'm not even gonna say negative, man, because there's always a balance. Mm-hmm. Negative got to balance off that good.
Yeah.
It was a learning situation to keep me.
That's it.
I jumped off the porch earlier to get me back on there mentally. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So the male influences, man, I had Hustlers.
Yeah.
In my that was influencing me. I had pool sharks, card sharks. Yeah. You know, that's all I ever seen. But the good part that I got out of a lot of them, man. I ain't gonna say no names, but when I was young, this guy was a card and a pool shark. Mm-hmm. And he always said to me, and it still stick to this day, I tell my son this, I tell all kids this. He always say, don't be a follower. He always said that. That's what I remember.
Yeah.
And I might have been 6 or 7. He said, you don't be no follower. If you ain't come up with it, don't do it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking like, why? But it always stuck to me.
Yeah.
It always stuck.
Yeah.
It kept me out of gangs. Mm-hmm. It kept me from getting the wrong cars at the wrong time, or having sticky fingers when I shouldn't, being smooth enough to let somebody else go do it and tell them. Right. You know what I'm saying? So,
hey, keep it real, man. Keep it real.
So I'm gonna say, man, I wouldn't change anything. I really wouldn't. Yeah. I definitely did. I had one male influence in my life that I didn't understand how positive and great it was until I was older.
Yeah.
And he actually, man, this guy used to, I think I was probably about 12. He was one of them, you know, conscious brothers. They all want to call him conscious brothers.
Yeah.
He was straight up.
He was woke.
He was woke. You know, I mean, he used to come at us in ways that, you know, straight, no cut on it, you know, just straight to the point.
Yeah.
And it scared most. Because out of our circle, I probably was the one that grasped onto it, only because I had a curiosity.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he'll come get us, and my mom will take us to church. He might come get us and go take us to a mosque. You know what I'm saying? The same day.
Yeah.
Or pull a book out and tell us where we from, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it never stuck. It never really dawned on me, you know, until probably, man, I was probably 18.
Okay.
Everything he used to tell us or tell me, I used to listen, it hit me. Just one day it hit me, man. Mm-hmm. It started maybe looking at the world different.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But that helped me out on a lot of stuff, like, you know, to where I'm at today. So I give him all the credit on that part of just putting me on the right line and making it come back. Somebody must have popped me in the back of the head, my subconscious. So I say he kept me straight, and I ain't know it until I was older.
I got you.
Yeah,
so. Yeah, it go like that a lot of times, man. Yeah, you don't understand that wisdom when you first have it delivered to you.
Yeah.
But then when in moments where you grow up and you actually need it.
Yeah, it kicks in.
It takes some time for it to marinate sometimes. Yeah.
So, I mean, that influence-wise, I say my coaches. Had a coach, a Mexican, out of everybody, came and took us out of the neighborhood. He seen our talent.
Yeah.
Took us out of the neighborhood, took us all over the country, man. Mm-hmm. So he gave us an opportunity. So I say that was a positive influence. And a couple of other folks that's probably wasn't the best guidance in a whole.
Yeah.
But, you know, they guided us to – they told us, hey, you don't need to deal with that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And took us, you know, to a more of a positive situation. Mm-hmm. But it was all over, man. Mm-hmm. Now, as far as a male,
role model. You had the full spectrum.
I got the full spectrum.
Because it's real talk. Sometimes you can learn what not to do from some people.
If my dad listens to this, I doubt it, though. I might show him. I love this dude to death. And the only reason I tell him, I love you to death, because you showed me what not to do.
Hmm. It's like that sometimes.
You know, I tell him that.
Yeah, be like that.
He showed me what not to do. I mean, it ain't his fault.
Mm-hmm.
He grew up in that era. I tell kids that. I say, well, not kids. I tell my daughter and my son my son don't really get it yet. My daughter do. Mm-hmm. You know, I say, you know, sometimes y'all got it good. Because as far as us, you know, we seen some of the worst. Because the 80s, 70s,
90s,
you know,
drug epidemic.
And they went to work on us. I mean, people used to laugh back in the day, and y'all know y'all on y'all. I know y'all up on y'all music. I heard y'all talking.
No doubt.
But people used to laugh back in the day, man. Like when Puff them came in with the shiny clothes, the watches. Mm-hmm. Man, that probably was the best thing happened, because now we want to go get money. I used to listen to Wu-Tang and everybody else.
You want to go hit them, go fight.
Shoot up the whole hustle block.
Yes. Show up. So, man, really helped us out. So I tell my kids, I say, man, y'all blessed because all of us not lost.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. Absolutely.
So, yeah. Okay,
you talk about the music, bro. M.O.P. killed like 6.5 people on every song.
Yeah. Yeah.
On average.
We happen to be real life. Yeah, sure enough, boy.
For real.
Throw some M.O.P. on. Why you hype super fast, man? Put some M.O.P.
Yeah, throw on M.O.P. I got to get my Tim's and my Carhartt sweatshirt.
Sure enough, boy. Yeah. Sure enough.
Saying real.
Sure enough. I come from the era of Tim Boots and shorts, man.
Exactly.
Yeah. Slouch socks.
I'm saying the summertime.
Yeah, man. Yeah. Tim's year round.
For real.
Oh, yeah, though.
For real, though. Summertime shoes, Tim's. Wintertime shoes, Tim's.
Tim's.
Side yeah. roll. But yeah, it's wild, man. You talk about some of the situations, whatnot, like not only that, you know, you've been through, but some of the things you've seen kids go through. And working with them sometimes, like we know, you know, every now and then you got the ones that listen to you because they like they trying to just get you out their face. And then you have the ones that, you know, listen to you because they genuinely taking it in.
Mm-hmm.
But have you ever run into a kid that is just like, yo, like you not getting it? And then seeing them turn around later, and when you thought they're not getting it, they actually, what you were saying started sinking in. You ever run into anything like that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I have, man. So I have.
Mm-hmm.
And what it actually, man, that's made me understand, well, you can't save them all.
Yeah.
So once I learned that I couldn't save them all, what I started doing, and I do it now, I sit back, I observe real good.
Yeah.
So I started trying to look and see which kid got in his eyes.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
he don't quite understand that what I'm telling him, but it might have been one word or one situation that he may relate it to, and
mm-hmm.
I seen that sparkle in his eyes, so I know, okay, we ain't gonna lose him.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if we just stick around, you know, just a little bit, he gonna be good. But it's been different situations. From the basketball standpoint, I had a kid, probably one of the best kids when I got him. He was probably seventh grader, about 6'4", 6'5".
Mm. Lord.
Couldn't dribble the basketball, couldn't do nothing. He came up here.
Like height talent.
Yeah.
Yeah. He came to Columbia from Tampa. He lost both his parents in a car wreck.
Mm. Wow.
So mentally, he was shut down.
Yeah.
You know, when he first came, people seen his height. He went to try it out for everybody. Mm. Everybody cut him. They had time to work with him. So I figured, okay, let's just work with him. I see some things, let's work with him.
Mm-hmm.
Kid got real good by the time he graduated. Well, by the time he was in the 12th grade, he was the top center in the state.
Oh, nice.
Mm-hmm. 11th grade year, I told him, no, 10th grade. 7th, 10th grade. The last year that I had that first team I was talking about, team good.
Mm-hmm.
He asked, he said, Coach, I want to go play for, he asked me, could he play for somebody else for a tournament?
Mm-hmm.
I said, cool, yeah, man. Now, this a kid I take home, right? And I told him, I said, look, I never give you nothing, because if I start giving you something, you're going to think that you entitled to that. You ain't going to work mm-hmm. for it.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, cool, you know, let me speak to the coach or whatever. The coach called me. I said, yeah, you good. You know, you good people. He could go with you, you know, if it's going to expose his kid to more colleges or whatever. Go ahead. So, that whole weekend, I thought he went with that particular coach. Mm-hmm. That coach called me Sunday, like, hey, what happened? I see your kid up here with another team. Wow. I said, another team? What? Yeah. You know, what happened?
Yeah.
So I called the kid. And the biggest trick you could get in travel ball is somebody giving you free pair of shoes. That's like the biggest trick. They do it all the time, you know. So come to find out, another particular team gave him some shoes and all this other stuff, sold him some dreams,
mm-hmm.
and he went with that, you know. And he was so disappointed. He thought I'd be so disappointed that, you know, just from everything he'd been through, mentality.
Yeah.
He didn't really talk about it. He wouldn't really come around me, so he just went.
Mm-hmm.
And stayed with that particular team.
Yeah.
So he probably called me like a year later after he made his decision on what college to go to.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, man, nobody, I'm not mad at you. You know, you did what you did.
Yeah.
I said, but, I mean, you might realize 10 years from now that might have been a wrong decision, or it might have been good, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But it was a wrong decision as far as, I mean, he's good going to school, playing college ball, all that stuff. But, mm-hmm. he probably could have been high up on the total pole, you know, as far as the shit. They, the people who got gave him those shoes, out of 40 offers he had, he picked the wrong offer to take him to that next level. That's all. But it's all good. Kid's still good. We still talk, you know. He still called me for little stuff. Now, once he figured out, I went mad.
Yeah.
You know, but so little stuff like that. Mm-hmm. As far as from a mentoring standpoint, kid right now I'm proud of, it's basketball, but it's also mentoring. This kid was one of the best high school kids. Still kept getting in trouble. He from the streets, just point blank from the streets. He can't stay in school. It's crazy. I spoke to him before I came here. But he finished his basketball career. He finished his college career. He's about to graduate after this year.
That's dope.
You know what I'm saying? I just always get on him and tell him, look, man, it's nothing. You can come back, have fun with your friends, your family, but, man, you don't want to stay around here.
Yeah.
You know, I always stay in his ear. So he finished. I'm proud of him. I mean, he's not finished yet. He got a couple more months. But I'm proud of him.
You can see the end now.
You can see the end.
He took a journey. I'm talking about a journey. So, so just little stuff like that, though.
That's wild.
Is like any particular kid like that just stands out that you just like super proud of? Like just, you know.
I would say this kid name. I'm super proud of this kid. It's basketball too.
Give me a shine.
This kid, Jarrell Brantley, man. He he at the College of Charleston right now. Probably the top player. He won freshman of the year last year.
Okay.
But he took a hard road too. I'm proud. Good kid though. Proud of him. He went to a prep school. I got him in the prep school. He had to go to another prep school. Uh-huh. And I used to always tell him when he was young, he just feel like I'm good enough. But he wasn't. So he wasn't. You know, he was okay. He big. He was okay.
Yeah.
But I always said that he might need to take the hard road because he going to wake up later now. So I think he woke. He doing good. I mean, we talk, but we don't talk every day or nothing like that. But I see he grew to be a man. I'm real proud of that kid, man.
That's what's up, man.
Real proud of that kid.
Yeah, absolutely. It's good to have those. You know, it makes you, you know, feel good. Not that you're doing it for your own feelings or whatnot, but just when you know that you've put in the work and you've invested in somebody, and to see them actually grasp what you was trying to put into
it.
They give you the juice to keep going.
Confirmation. Yeah. I knew it was gonna come back. 2013, man. November 2013, I was really about to get this thing up, man. I was making a decision, man, to go with Tell You Work the NBA scout. They down in Miami.
Yeah.
So
you like Miami though.
I don't really need too much more to convince me to go to Miami.
Exactly. So I was gonna move down there, man. The only thing that made me even think of not moving was my kids, because I'm with my kids all the time. So I was like, man, I'm gonna be 9-10 hours away.
Yeah,
probably just get them in the summer. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And so I took a trip to the beach, man. And I'm thinking more business. Mm-hmm. So that's why I took the trip. But when I was at that trip, man, I say things happen for a reason. You know, sometimes it can be good, sometimes it can be bad.
Yeah.
I would say this. I won't say that this happened for me or for a reason. It might have happened for everybody else that was involved, and hopefully they figured out how to turn a negative to a positive, you know. But when I was down there, man, I have a younger brother, and it's probably a little cruel of them, but I always talk to them, you know, and try to. I try not to talk too much. I try to just show through action.
Yeah, absolutely.
I try to show them that you ain't got to do this, you ain't got to do that, you could do this way or whatever. Yeah. But the one kid that was in his little circle, man, his best friend, all of like brothers, he was the one listening, you know. And I was at the beach, man, and he came home. He came to my mom's house, you know, before he went to truck school. You know, I was like, yo, he about to go. He go finish trucking.
Yeah.
You know, the rest of them going to start doing some positive stuff.
Yeah.
But yeah, that particular night, man, it's crazy because the situation, from what I hear, some stuff that happened in high school. These kids have been out of school for about 3-4 years, man. But some guys ran up in my mom's yard and shot at a couple of them. You know, probably shot like three people, but ended up killing him.
Wow.
You know, and that was tough. That was tough for me and everybody that's involved. But that made me stay and continue doing what I'm doing. Mm-hmm. Not saying that they wasn't per se in my, you know, the kids in my organization, but he's like my little brother. I see every day. So I figured, man, I gotta stay because I don't want no other kids I'm around to, you know, just fall.
Yeah, something happened like they
that to especially like that, man. Mm-hmm. So that kind of kept me to kept me going. And like I said, I was 2013, and after that, man, truthfully, after I decided to stay, my organization actually, that's how we were going international. It ramped up big time. Yeah. You know, it ain't been as hard as it been before that.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it ramped up, man. Like I say, things, that's just the universe. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Things happen.
That's
for
right.
a reason.
Absolutely.
But yeah, that's that right there. Like you say, confirmation. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes it speak to you in different ways, man. So, yeah, that was a confirmation. That was a confirmation. So
yeah, man, definitely stop saying no to stuff. Cause that's, you told us two stories already.
Hey, I got a book, a movie. I'm telling you, man. No lie to y'all.
Man, that's what's up, man.
You know, that I don't. I tell people I'd rather. I gotta say it. CYR. I don't know if y'all guys got me on Facebook or whatever. 95% of anything I deal with, I try to make sure it's positive.
Positivity
over negativity. That other 5%, because you got to be aware, you know what I'm saying? But I try to stay positive, and I got my saying, man, is I call it SOAR. That's how you, if you pronounce it, but CYR, you create your own reality. So
that's real.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. That's thought. That's your environment. That's your decisions. You create it.
Yeah.
So I really believe in that, man. So that's, you know, that's what I try to do with all those situations. That's my therapy.
Okay, I'm with you on that. I mean, I get my share ratchet in every day too. It's just a share of it.
Yeah, because Mike, the only person I know that actually has a World Star Hip Hop app on his phone.
Hey man, look here. You ain't the only one. Hey, look.
I'm saying,
we joke about this, but no lie. Oh, y'all ready for this? Listen, I've been upset for the past 3 weeks. Because every Friday, I look forward to World Star Vine clips. Like, that's my entertainment, bro.
It is. 5-10 minutes sometimes, man.
That's right. Let me get my entertainment, then I'm going to be back on my vibe.
Yeah, that's it, man.
That's my comfort zone sometimes.
It be positive stuff out there sometimes.
Oh, yeah, sometimes.
Like, really? Just like, what's the percentage?
Probably the flip side of what you just said. 95.5
All right, it's just 5%.
Say maybe 40%.
Maybe 40%. I don't know about 40%.
Maybe 40%.
I don't know about.
You know, good and well, that positive stuff don't sell, man.
Well, you know, 86% of all statistics are made up. So
that is true.
I'm making it up now.
I'm gonna shoot that out there. That's dope, man. That's dope. All right, so we're gonna transition here since it's March Madness, and before we go there. Can you still hoop, man?
Who?
You.
Man, I still play. I had a, I missed last week, but I shot the lights out the other day. I had like 20.
He said it like I was going to challenge him. No, I was just asking.
We can take it outside right now. I'm wearing ball shorts under my jeans right now.
The worst thing I could do, I could never tell a ball player, you could never forget how to play.
Yeah.
But your body might tell you different.
Father Time's undefeated.
Yeah, man. And I never thought that until.
Yeah. Until it started happening. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
If I can't breathe, I'm in trouble. That's 1 week, I'm in trouble.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
Drop off is real.
I got a I told myself today I got a 40th birthday coming up in June. I said on my birthday I'm gonna dunk.
Dunk
dog.
Like 10 foot.
Dunk again.
Yeah, that's what's up.
that's my goal.
You gonna start drinking milk?
I know I'm fragile, dog. Frailty. Everything brittle, man. I done dislocated my knee 3 times.
Oh, and a dunk?
And a fracture my ankle. Yeah, I'm a dunk, man.
I still got arthritis.
I can dunk, man. Wow. I'm gonna get back to it. And
you, 40 years old, all of 5'10", and you gonna dunk?
Yes. Yeah. Back at it again, man.
Hey, vaya con Dios. Go with God.
I'm saying, hey man, all I gotta do is one time. I'm good.
Well, you
gonna
make somebody get it on film?
I'm good money
because I don't want to hear about that you did it. I need to see that you did it.
Gotta see it. Yeah. I need one time. I'm good money. Boom. That's it. That's it. That's it.
Yeah, we gotta videotape that.
I haven't decided if I'm gonna count it off the bounce or I gotta keep it in my hand.
Well, we gotta put some rules. Yeah, we gotta put some rules and regulations. Wait, on
off,
this
the, off the bounce, bounce? Like, off the bounce is easier now.
Like, okay,
you ain't gonna be comfortable with that off the bounce. You ain't gonna be satisfied.
I ain't be satisfied. I probably won't be.
Feel like you
I probably won't be. Hey, real talk. That's why you gotta put rules on it. Like, no mini balls.
Nah.
No WNBA ball.
No.
Like real, like regulation.
Yeah, a real ball on a real 10-foot hoop.
On a real 10-foot rim.
That's what I'm talking about.
Okay. So how are you training yourself to build up to this dunk fest?
Ain't no training going on.
I made a decision. I told you I made a decision today.
Okay.
I made a decision today.
Quite figured out.
Yeah. I mean, I get that work in.
So he probably did some like body weight lunges in his living room.
Nah,
and a tall glass of milk.
Nah, I didn't do any of that.
Yeah, that was today.
Nah, I ain't do it. But I'm gonna get it in though. Okay. Y'all write it down. It's on the podcast.
I'm saying it's recorded. Your
June 27th, dog.
June 27th.
I need to see that.
Bam. They're like, oh, snap, he still got it.
No, it's gonna be bam. Oh, he broke his leg.
He hurt himself again.
Three replacements, man.
Yeah, bear in mind, I haven't played basketball in about 4 years.
This is gonna be so ugly, dog.
Yeah,
because it's so ugly.
The last time I played, I fractured my ankle.
So you ready? This is my next question. Are you ready for the mental part of trying to go out there and
yeah,
for real?
Yeah,
you got some serious injuries.
Yeah, like being hurt don't bother me, man. So I'm
obviously not, because it happened a couple times.
I'm a man for that.
Glass, man.
Mr. Glass. I did what's old boy from Portland? He kept getting broken.
Greg Oden.
Greg Oden.
Yeah, LeBron daddy.
Yeah.
You're the only dude to ever come to the league as a rookie. Looked like he was about to be a retiree.
For real. Yeah.
Like that.
Oh, man.
Wait, he a rookie? Yeah, I did for 3 minutes and break my leg.
That's wild.
Yep. All right, man. Yeah, all right, so bet. So you can still hoop in this March Madness, man. So every year, we do a bracket.
But not like a regular bracket.
Bracket. That's not what we do, man. We do the board of directors bracket.
Oh, yeah.
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 So,
special.
Yeah. So last year, our bracket was 90s R&B groups. Right?
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm trying to key y'all in.
I'm saying, man. You got it.
Y'all let me do all the talking. I'm trying to key y'all in. Yeah, but last year, we did 90s R&B groups, and Jodeci ended up winning.
Yep. We had two sides. We had the male groups and we had the female groups on one side. So yeah, it was Jodeci came with the win. If y'all hadn't noticed, if y'all listen to us kind of often, Jodeci seems to be like an ongoing theme that we have. Like somehow, some way, Jodeci.
Yeah, Jodeci comes in.
Oh yeah. You find an opportunity every episode to try to sing, and you can't sing.
He can't dunk either. That's not stopping.
Yeah, nothing stops Mike. Yeah. The inability to do something does not deter Mike in any way, shape, or form.
It's great, man. Yeah, I'm saying, the Bible say, when you sing your praises to the Lord, they don't say sound great. They just sang it.
Yeah. Okay, your joyful noise, though.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know what kind of glorification you're getting out of that.
Hey, it sound good to me.
That's all that matter, right?
I'm saying, makes me happy.
Yeah, you need to get that checked out.
Makes me happy. Makes me happy.
But yeah, man, we did the bracket. We had 16 male groups, 16 female groups. We seeded them and everything, broke that joint down. We had regions. We had a Temptations region. We had the Supremes region. You know what I'm saying? Like the classic. I'm pulling it up on the website right now. Yeah, so it was episode 43. If anybody else want to go back out and check that out, because that episode was pretty much straight dedicated to the bracket breakdown.
Yeah, we go back and discuss how we fleshed out each round.
Yeah, because somebody in this table, I ain't gonna call no names, but somebody at this table made some real strong arguments for Jagged Edge.
I was lobbying hard, like
Jagged Edge. Over Jodeci too.
Jagged Edge.
No, I didn't say over Jodeci.
Jodeci. I was like, what?
It was over that particular.
Oh, like Jagged Edge.
Particular group they were paired against.
I'm saying, well, we ain't called no names out, but
I'm saying that
somebody still defend them kind of hard.
Hit dog will holler.
Still defend them.
Dog will holler.
I'm a holler, man, because that wasn't right what y'all did.
He had a good run.
Yeah, he had a good.
they did have a good run, but I mean, it's like
it was in the game.
When people think about like the strong, like the yo, the real, like, 90s R&B male groups. Like, how far down that list does it take before you get to Jagged Edge?
Look, man.
Like, Jagged Edge ain't top five, dog. Top five out of the 90s?
It's super groups, man.
Yeah. No, I mean, they were better than the group they were paid against.
Oh, I'm pulling up this bracket. We're about to find out whether that's true.
You're pulling the bracket now.
Yeah. He said, "What? 12? Scott, we're gonna get you another. We gotta get a fifth mic.
That's right. Exactly. Right, while he pulling that up, man, you keeping up with college ball?
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, college. Yeah, I love college ball.
So you liking the tournament this year?
Man, I'm a Kansas man.
Kansas man.
We lost today before I walked in here, but we needed that loss. We waited too much. We needed that loss. We need that loss before it, man. I'm a Kansas dude.
Yeah, you don't want it to come up in the tournament.
I mean, we got, yeah, exactly. I don't really have no team, no college team I hate.
Yeah.
But
Duke.
I hated Duke in like high school.
For myself, yeah, Duke.
Yeah, I mean, all I hated, day I hated Duke in high school.
They're not good enough to be hated this year.
I'm going to tell you why. We beat Duke, so they might hate us. But I liked Grayson Allen, though, and I like the other kid.
Grayson Allen, Mr. All Elbows and Knees.
I love that. I mean,
Play with heart, though.
That's that old school, you know what I'm saying? He looked like a white Charles Oakley out there, man. Like, I like that. Play hard, though.
Yeah.
I like him, and I like, what's the other kid? I like Grayson.
Off Duke? Talking about Off Duke?
Yeah.
Phillip, that's his last name. Freshman.
He doing his thing right now.
Freshman.
I think I know
talking about Kennard. You're talking about Luke Kennard.
Luke Kennard.
He got a smooth jump.
Tate.
Shot.
Is it Tate?
Tate. The swing forward.
The freshman. Tatum.
That's it.
Tatum. I like Tatum game. He got an NBA game.
I just watched him yesterday beat up on Clemson.
Yeah. He was
damn, bro. I said, Clemson's so sorry, man.
Yeah, man. Clemson don't have to go to. Yeah.
They so sorry, man. See,
that game shouldn't have been that close.
No, it shouldn't have been.
Yeah, I've been arguing with Duke fans. They hate me right now.
It shouldn't have been. That shouldn't have been a blowout.
Oh, my God. They hate me.
We need to reevaluate our relationship.
I know it.
Duke? Voluntarily? Like, then in a court mandate that you a fan of Duke?
Wow.
I'm sorry to hear that.
Be one.
Yeah, you don't have a mic. You all off mic talking, kind of jumping the conversation. Yeah, Takara over there talking about she a Duke fan.
She a Duke fan. Okay.
We need to look back at this relationship that we got right here. Because somewhere down the line, we done went wrong.
See, you got the
so you
got
to be a North Carolina.
Yes, okay. Sir. Okay. Okay. Absolutely.
You know, Carolina fan
had the blue
forever.
Too. I see.
Forever. I mean, between North Carolina and Duke, I mean, when you look at it, how many North Carolina people have gone on to the league and won championships versus how many Duke players have gone on to the league and won championships? Like, name somebody besides, like, what's my man, Kyrie and Shane Battier.
That's because Duke just started to produce real good NBA players.
Yeah.
The only Greg Hill and then...
That's real rap. Meanwhile, you got James Worthy, Michael Jordan, Sam Perkins. I mean,
yeah, you go to
Rasheed Wallace, history lesson. Stackhouse.
They sound like a Cowboys fan.
No, because I actually cheer for somebody who wins. I'm not one of the delusional Cowboy fans that think every year is my year, and we end up going 8-8 every year. Every year.
Cowboys.
Nah, bump that.
Cowboys.
Nah,
Cowboys. Bump the Cowboys. You got the bracket pulled up.
Yeah, the bracket's pulled up. Okay, so I thought we'd had a male side and a female side. Looks like what we did is that we mixed it.
Yeah, we ranked them.
Yeah, we ranked them. Yeah, so we got like male teams versus female teams.
You see it?
Real talk. This is serious.
Yeah.
This debate we about to have this next episode or this next one we do, it's about to be real.
Yo.
It's going to be real. Yeah, Jagged Edge... In the first round, Jagged Edge was a 4 seed. And there was a 4 seed in the Four Tops region. And they was up against 702, which was a 5 seed.
That was a wash.
Hold on, did they struggle against 702? That wasn't an argument, was it?
No, that wasn't an argument.
I don't think so. But they went on to the next round to play Jodeci, which was a number 1 seed. So it was a 1 versus 4.
And he actually argued that Jagged Edge should have won that.
No, I don't think I argued that. I think
we can pull the tape, dog. Yeah, pull the tape.
Pull the tape.
Pull the tape. I might have been arguing like hits or something like that.
It should have been a higher seed. I think that's what we're arguing about.
Higher seed. That's what you're going.
Who you
gonna
move him up ahead of?
Who you gonna move him ahead of?
7-0-2.
I mean, total was a 4 seed. Shy was a 4 seed.
What's his other one?
112 was a 4 seed. I mean, you look at the 3 seeds, you got Mint Condition, you got Tony, you got Drew Hill, and you got Bell Bib DeVoe. They ain't higher than none of them.
How far Tony with?
Tony, where did I see them?
Over here.
Up top. They beat Troop in the first round. And then they lost to Destiny's Child.
Oh, that was tough.
Yeah,
it was tough.
You gotta give. How they lost? I wanted to hear that argument.
Well, I mean,
Beyonce might have just. That was like LeBron or something. Though.
We didn't.
That was like a superstar.
That's kind of how it. That's how it kind of washed out. It was like who had the bigger hits.
Yeah, that's kind of how it.
See, this year we're going to have to remember to keep score because you know it's three of us. So there's always a tiebreaker.
Yeah.
So some of these people, some of them won 3-0. Yeah. Some of them won 2-1. So, you know, we don't have the scores on
that.
That
was a tough matchup, right?
Yeah.
Because Tony's still around, man. They probably still get money around the world.
But we actually had a 2 seed come out. We had Black Street as a 2 seed beat SWV in the Final Four.
Yeah.
Yeah, that, but you got legendary.
You don't get a mic.
Yeah,
you got that's legendary. Right. Come on,
Backstreet. Hey, before I let you go,
Mike, you ain't got to sing every song, man. We know how to do it. We bought the albums. We was there.
I'm a connoisseur, dog.
Yeah, I gotta try that. That was creative.
Yeah, man. So yeah, man, the whole bracket is out there. Like I said, it's episode 43 that we did that. So yeah, that's what we're doing. Next episode.
Yeah.
So what's that or what's the...
Oh, man, we kind of debating rather. We won't put that out there now. Maybe it's going to be a surprise. But
no, we can let them know.
You want to tell people?
Yeah, we'll tell them.
Okay, check us out. We super specific this year with this one. Again, we going back to the 90s. But we're doing debut rap albums from the 90s.
Debut.
Yeah, so, yeah, you know...
I'm not going to be here, so yeah. God give... Final Four prediction.
Go ahead, man. Go ahead.
My Final Four.
Final
prediction.
Four.
I'm gonna go with Illmatic.
Okay.
Nas. I'm gonna go with Reasonable Doubt. Well, hold on. Now, let me ask this question. Do y'all go with? Was it big at the time, or did it grow to be a classic?
It's just got to be the first album.
Yeah, it's got to be the first album.
For rap artists from the 90s.
I'm gonna go with Illmatic. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna do Reasonable Doubt.
Classics.
Ready to Die.
Mm-hmm.
I gotta do Ready to Die. And I gotta be biased. Oh, the 90s. Hold up. I can't be too biased.
It's gotta be 90s and it's gotta be the first album from that artist.
It's a lot to choose from.
Doggy Style. Yeah.
Doggy Style?
Yeah. That gotta be, yeah.
That's a lot to choose from.
I'm saying that's real.
90s to. The argument I had not too long ago was the best music. Came like the year was that the year is probably been like 94 to like
96
heavy with
but I kind of agree.
I think most of us would agree, but is that because that was the formative years of our lives? Like we, you know what I'm saying, we were coming of age during that time.
I did it the way we were saying, like it's music that hasn't died. Our kids might could listen to it and still like some.
It's still relevant.
Yeah, we was young and they put on what's old school, real old school,
like Marvin Gaye or something
like
that.
Ozzy Brothers.
It's still relevant to the day.
Around that time, we could pull that Reasonable Doubt, Illmatic.
Yeah,
that Ready to Die. The kids, they don't even make music like that no more. Storyline.
Yeah, you're right. You're right.
But, you know,
that's a good Final Four though.
I think it's gonna be a good debate. Yeah, your Final Four is strong. Your Final Four is East Coast heavy though.
Oh, the East Coast. I mean, what I thought about it, like
East Coast.
I mean, you leaving out Southern Playlist and Cadillac Music.
Oh my.
You leaving out Goody Mob.
Saying in '90s.
Hold up.
Soul Food being left out.
Let me redo all that.
Say something reconsider,
man. I did. That was so bad. I was giving Snoop a reasonable. Listen, Soul Food.
and he left it out. We didn't.
I didn't mean soul food.
We haven't debated yet.
Yeah. We ain't even seeded the brackets yet.
I done shut down some New York cats with the soul food. They never like who so who. Then I turned it on. They were like, I gotta take Snoop out.
You gotta take Snoop.
You gonna take Snoop out and put Goody Mob in?
I put Goody Mob. Yeah. I do that.
Now you leaving out 400 degrees.
That was a dope album.
I got to, cause that Goody Mob.
You leaving out into the 36 Chambers.
I got to, cause I mean the Goody Mob kind of.
What else you leaving out? You leaving out Iron Man, Ghostface Killer,
DMX.
DMX is dark and hell.
Hold on, 36. You can't put 36 Chambers.
Why not? That's 93.
That's 93. It dropped in the 90s.
That was the debut though.
First Wu-Tang album.
First Wu-Tang album. Yeah.
Well, no, I still gotta put it. Listen, this is why I gotta put Goody Mob. Cause they hit on all levels. Mentally, they, you know what I'm saying? They, mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Politically,
yeah.
That's soulful. I still live.
Yeah, you left out.
When I leave.
You left out.
You leaving out the Chronic?
I like the Chronic. Well, yeah. That's.
You leaving out Only Built for Cuban Links?
That was all right.
The Purple Tape?
I like it.
I'm sorry, what now?
The Purple Tape. This is why I say that.
Gonna make the Final Four, though.
Nah. I like that tape.
Yeah.
The Purple Tape.
Purple Tape?
That's a.
That's Only Built for Cuban.
But who I named though, they still, what I'm saying, yeah. It's like
Miss Education.
That's tough. Y'all gonna be already y'all gonna have tiebreakers overtime.
Miss Education Lauryn Hill.
But you said rap though.
I mean, she rapped a little bit on that album.
Nah. That's the best. Okay.
It's gonna be tough, man.
Oh yeah, it's gonna be hard.
There's three of us though.
So it won't there'll never be a tie. What? Lauryn Hill was.
What was it?
98.
Oh,
she just made it.
Yep.
Yeah. That's tough, yo. Y'all gonna be
it's gonna be a heated debate, but what are you talking about? Yeah.
You got Tupacalypse now?
Yeah. Classic. That's people don't even leave it back there, they wanna talk about that. That's a claim. You turn it on right now.
It's not amazing.
He talking about stuff that's going on right now.
Yeah, exactly. So that's what we doing next podcast, man.
Yeah, I need to be here.
We'll put together a bracket. We'll send it to you.
You can fill
out your bracket.
Definitely.
Yeah, we'll do that. Actually, man, we should just put it out there for the people to look at, man.
Oh yeah, we're gonna do that. We got to seed it first, man. We got to divide it up, because what we're going to do is we're going to have regions. We got, you know, East Coast, we got West Coast, we got Down South, and we got Midwest. Yeah. So
we're going to see them out. Yeah,
we're going to give each region 18.
I can't give the West Coast a good, like, the best album other than that Snoop situation, but.
Not even the Chronic?
Chronic was 2000, though, right?
No. We're talking about the first Chronic, not 2001.
Yeah.
Well, they had a couple of
that was 92.
Albums, but they had, like. I was 92. Singles.
Yeah, they had some Lodies, singles.
Farside, all them dudes.
Souls of Mischief.
They had some bangers now. Yeah. They had some bangers.
Yeah. So, I mean, we got, I think it's about 55, 60 groups on here that dropped albums. We got to narrow this thing down and seed these joints.
Mm-hmm.
Who looked that up? Y'all just got the date.
Actually, just go like Wikipedia, Google, man. Who dropped and when? Yeah, because I mean, it's a lot on here, but it's real.
Debate.
It's East Coast heavy.
Good debate.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
man. We try to get as many people involved as we can, man. Just let them. Hey, man, this is what we do.
Y'all need to go live with that. Y'all might get a million views. Trying to figure out they arguing amongst themselves.
Nah, y'all crazy. Yeah.
We might have to do that for real, though. We got the technology. We might have to make that happen.
Yeah, man.
Now, the one thing I wish we could do is we could actually put the bracket live online and let people fill it out online. And then who everybody's picking.
Yeah.
Whatnot. And then
that'd be dope.
We do ours. We might still find a way. If anybody knows how to do that, hit us up.
Yeah. Yeah, we get to that point, man. Yeah. We'll figure it out.
Yeah, that would be dope for let people play together, play with us.
Play
online.
With us, yeah.
And then we just give, you know, because it's three of us. Yeah. No ties.
Yeah. So. Now, do you play Marsh Madness brackets every year?
I surely do.
Okay.
How often do you win, though?
I'm downloaded Friday.
Downloaded, okay.
Yeah, we do with our team. Matter of fact, we got all the coaches, everybody organization doing one. I probably do like six try to win $1 billion. I know that's right. Well, that's right. Back, right. Okay. Yeah, so I do that, but that's probably about it. I always put Kansas. I do the unbiased one. I pick a mid major all the time. I love that. Like, yeah. If we make it, and a mid major beat us, I'm good with that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I mean, I definitely do the brackets. Definitely.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. We do a board of directors one every year too.
Yeah.
That we put
which
out there.
Which I usually win.
Yeah. Which you usually win. Usually win.
So you still consider Gonzaga?
No, a mid-major? A mid major.
Yeah.
I hate. Quote me on this.
Yeah. Looking at the camera on that.
I do not like.
Get the camera.
I do not like the way. I'm not saying I don't like West Coast teams, but I don't like the way they rank them because they don't.
They don't really play.
It's not as strong. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like we used to say, like the ACC. You can have an argument that the Big Ten. I mean the Big East.
Big East, yeah.
The Big East used to be like rival. Now they done messed up the Big East, so you don't really know. But like the West Coast never. I feel the same way in football. They have at least three that's powerhouses. They run the whole year. Then they get to the tournament.
Mm-hmm. And gag it up.
Yeah. So I mean, I don't like the ranking.
I don't like the ranking.
As far as Gonzaga, it's definitely still a mid-major. Mm-hmm. But how they rank them. Mm-hmm. Yeah, put them up there like that. I don't like that. They don't really play nobody other than if they run against Oregon or slide down to Arizona or something like that.
Yeah. What's a good team out there? UCLA, that's the only good team out there in the West right now? Powerhouse?
Probably.
Fluke. Wow. I mean, because I don't think I like the kid Ball. Loves a Ball, but to me, they doing the same way they did do with Curry in the NBA with him.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Like he's a marketing wise, he's the best.
Yeah,
but the way he play, you gonna have kids out there trying to imitate
him,
and it's gonna kill the sport. You know what I'm saying? That's not real. You know, he's good. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying he's not good. He's good.
Yeah.
But I mean, it's gonna be tough when he gets to that next level.
I got you. I haven't seen him play, man. Because
the game started like 10:30. Yeah. We got jobs.
Yeah, I got jobs. Get up in the morning, go to work.
He's exciting to watch, man. Yeah. Like he's exciting, but I want to see like I don't see nothing special. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like a Zion Williamson.
Yeah.
Your high school kid.
Oh yeah. Mm-hmm.
But he's special because he's a freak of nature.
Yeah. You know, absolutely.
I see Alonzo Ball. I mean, he's smart. You know, he looked like any other smart player, but they marketed him right now. Mm-hmm. So that's why.
Yeah, he got the best promoter out there in the business right now.
His daddy.
Putting it down, boy.
And the best one out of all three is the middle one to me, the one that's hurt, the middle son.
Uh-huh.
I like him better than all three. Not even the little kid, the younger one.
Yeah.
I think they hyping that type situation. He scored like, what, 100 or something? 92?
Yeah.
How you score 92?
Yeah, hanging court.
You not getting. Yeah. You score 20 on
cherry
me.
Cherry picking.
They say he was cherry picking though.
You score 20, you get hurt.
Real talk.
My bad. My bad.
You play by them 2002 Knicks rules right there.
Yeah. Over 18. Over 18 points, you gonna start feeling it. I got to.
You gonna really earn the points.
You gonna really earn the points.
You get my respect after the game.
Matter of fact, I hug you and all, but you gonna be hurting. You gonna remember scoring that on me. That's how I feel.
You will think twice before you come in the lane. Getting the forearm shiver.
Exactly. Body up, though. Body up.
Oh, man. That's dope.
Dude, man. Yeah. Right, y'all want to close it out, man?
Yeah, man. I think that was dope, man. Out, man. Robert, thank you for joining us, man.
Appreciate y'all, man. Anytime. Absolutely. I'm free. I like this.
Hey, man, it's a pleasure having you, man.
Yeah, absolutely.
And please, man, let the people know about your camp and how they can contact you or anything like
that. Yeah, absolutely.
Y'all, you go to our website. It's goodkidsworld.org. GoodKidsWorld.org. We'll have information out there about our camp. Oh, also, one of our coaches, he passed a couple months ago with a young brother with he had an enlarged heart.
Ooh, wow. Okay.
Yeah, so we have a bike ride for on April 15th.
Okay.
It's either gonna be at Drew Wellness Center or at King Park, but we have information out about that.
Okay.
So you know, we want people to come out with their kids. You know, the money's going to be half of the money to go back to the organization, and we're going to donate some money to the Heart Disease Foundation.
Okay.
You know, do something good to help keep his name alive. So it's going to be called the Ron Palmer Bike Ride. against heart disease. Okay. So we have that information out probably like by next week.
Okay.
Good. Sounds good.
Dope, man.
Yeah, man. Thank you, man, again for sharing with us, for, you know, allowing us to help you spread the word about what you do, man. Also joining in the conversation because I know basketball, it was right on time for you.
That's right.
Yeah, no doubt. Make sure we shout out to Masterpiece Audio and Photography for their sponsorship. We always appreciate them. Make sure we also shout out to Takara Creative Multimedia. Make sure you check MPA out, MPAExperience.com.
There you go.
Takara's over off camera making sure that I do everything right.
Yeah.
And CreativeMultimedia.com. Make sure you check them out. We appreciate them also.
We had to mention that Rob is going to be doing Manhood Academy next month.
Absolutely.
For us. So that's definitely. Anybody who's checking it out, man, who want to get more information, who want to actually see Robert in face to face, come out to Manhood Academy.
See him give out that work in person.
That's right. That's right, man. You know, that's every fourth Saturday.
Yeah, that's right.
Every fourth, so from 10 to 11.
Absolutely. Just and come see this us. One for March is going to be on March 25th. So, yeah.
Yeah.
That's going to be dope.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah, but we appreciate y'all listening. Make sure y'all check us out online at www.themakersofaman.com/podcast. If you have any thoughts, concerns, or hate mail for Mike, please email us at info@themakingsofaman.com. You can contact us by phone at 803-386-9660. Please rate us, subscribe us on iTunes, Stitcher, and Google Play. We're out there. And as always, we'll check y'all next time.
Hold on. Yo, tell them. We got a video. We're going to be on YouTube as well. Check us out there. Subscribe to us.
Yeah,
there.
Go to YouTube. Check the video out because, you know, not only can you listen to us, you can see us.
That's right.
And we something good to look at. So, you know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
Treat yourself.
Hold on.
Directly into the camera.
That's right.
If you listen on the podcast, this ain't doing nothing for you. But if you on video, you getting the real deal right now.
Treat, baby.
Man, we appreciate y'all as always. We check you out next time.
Peace.
That's it.